This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book a Week on the Concord and Merrimack Rivers by Henry David Thoreau. A Week on the Concord and Merrimack Rivers. Henry D. Thoreau. Author of Walden, etc. Where'er thou sailst, who sailed with me, though now thou climbest loftier mounts, and fairer rivers dost ascend, be thou my muse, my brother. I am bound for a distant shore, by a lonely isle, by a far Azore, there it is, the treasure I seek, on the barren sands of a desolate creek. I sailed up a river with a pleasant wind, new lands, new people, and new thoughts to find. Many fair reaches and headlands appeared, and many dangers were there to be feared. But when I remember where I have been, and the fair landscapes that I have seen, Carrot thou, Carrot, seemest the only permanent shore, the cape never rounded nor wandered o'er. Flumenach obliques sings it declivia ripus quae, diversa locis, partum sorbentor ab ipsa, in mare pervenient partum, campoque recepta, liberioris aquae, pro ripus litera pulsant. Caritavid carrot, met. I-39. He confined the rivers within their sloping banks, which in different places are part absorbed by the earth, part reach the sea, and being received within the plain of its freer waters, beat the shore for banks. Concord River. Beneath low hills, in the broad interval through which at will our Indian rivulet winds mindful still of sanep and of squaw, whose pipe and arrow oft the plow unburies, here in pine houses, built of new-fallen trees, supplanters of the tribe the farmers dwell. Carrot Emerson, carrot. The Muscataquid, or grass-ground river, though probably as old as the Nile or Euphrates, did not begin to have a place in civilized history, until the fame of its grassy meadows and its fish attracted settlers out of England in 1635, when it received the other but kindred name of Carrot Concord Carrot from the first plantation on its banks, which appears to have been commenced in a spirit of peace and harmony. It will be grass-ground river as long as grass grows and water runs here. It will be Concord River only while men lead peaceable lives on its banks. To an extinct race it was grass ground where they hunted and fished, and it is still perennial grass ground to Concord farmers who own the great meadows and get the hay from year to year. One branch of it, according to the historian of Concord, for I love to quote so good authority, rises in the south part of Hopkinton, and another from a pond and a large cedar swamp in Westboro, and flowing between Hopkinton and Southboro through Framingham, and between Sudbury and Wayland, where it is sometimes called Sudbury River, it enters Concord at the south part of the town, and after receiving the North or Assabeth River, which has its source a little farther to the north and west, goes out at the northeast angle, and flowing between Bedford and Carlisle, and through Billerica, empties into the Merrimack at Lowell. In Concord it is, in summer, from 4 to 15 feet deep and from 100 to 300 feet wide, but in the spring freshets, when it overflows its banks, it is in some places nearly a mile wide. Between Sudbury and Wayland the meadows acquire their greatest breadth, and when covered with water, they form a handsome chain of shallow vernal lakes, resorted to by numerous gulls and ducks. Just above Sherman's Bridge, between these towns, is the largest expanse, and when the wind blows freshly in a raw March day, heaving up the surface into dark and sober billows or regular swells, skirted as it is in the distance with alder swamps and smoke like maples, it looks like a smaller Lake Huron, and is very pleasant and exciting for a landsman to row or sail over. The farmhouses along the Sudbury shore, which rises gently to a considerable height, command fine water prospects at this season. The shore is more flat on the Wayland side, and this town is the greatest loser by the flood. Its farmers tell me that thousands of acres are flooded now, since the dams have been erected, where they remember to have seen the white honeysuckle or clover growing once, and they could go dry with shoes only in summer. Now there is nothing but blue joint and sedge and cut grass there, standing in water all the year round. For a long time, they made the most of the driest season to get their hay, working sometimes till 9 o'clock at night, sedulously paring with their scythes in the twilight round the hummocks left by the ice. But now it is not worth the getting when they can come at it, and they look sadly round to their woodlots and upland as a last resource. It is worth the while to make a voyage up this stream if you go no farther than Sudbury, only to see how much country there is in the rear of us, great hills and 100 brooks and farmhouses and barns and haystacks you never saw before, and men everywhere, Sudbury, that is Southborough men, and Wayland, and 9-acre corner men, and Bound Rock, where 4 towns bound on a rock in the river, Lincoln, Wayland, Sudbury, Concord. Many waves are there agitated by the wind, keeping nature fresh, the spray blowing in your face, reeds and rushes waving, ducks by the hundred, all uneasy in the surf, in the raw wind, just ready to rise, and now going off with a clatter and a whistling like riggers straight for Labrador, flying against the stiff gale with reefed wings, or else circling round first, with all their paddles briskly moving just over the surf, to reconnoiter you before they leave these parts, gulls wheeling overhead, muskrats swimming for dear life, wet and cold, with no fire to warm them by that you know of, their labored homes rising here and there like haystacks, and countless mice and moles and winged titmice along the sunny windy shore, cranberries tossed on the waves and heaving up on the beach, their little red skiffs beating about among the alders, such healthy natural tumult as proves the last day is not yet at hand. And there stand all around the alders, and birches, and oaks and maples full of glee and sap, holding in their buds until the waters subside. You shall perhaps run aground on Cranberry Island, only some spires of last year's pipegrass above water, to show where the danger is, and get as good a freezing there as anywhere on the northwest coast. I never voyaged so far in all my life. You shall see men you never heard of before, whose names you don't know, going away down through the meadows with long ducking guns with water-tight boots wading through the foul meadow grass on bleak windy distant shores with guns at half-cock, and they shall see teal, blue-winged, green-winged, sheldrakes, whistlers, black ducks, ospreys, and many other wild and noble sights before night, such as they who sit in parlors never dream of. You shall see rude and sturdy, experienced and wise men keeping their castles, or teaming up their summer's wood, or chopping alone in the woods, men fuller of talk and rare adventure in the sun and wind and rain than a chestnut is of meat, who were out not only in 75 and 1812, but have been out every day of their lives, greater men than Homer or Chaucer or Shakespeare, only they never got time to say so, they never took to the way of writing. Look at their fields, and imagine what they might write, if ever they should put pen to paper. Or what have they not written on the face of the earth already, clearing and burning and scratching and harrowing and plowing and subsoiling, in and out and over again and again, erasing what they had already written for want of parchment. As yesterday and the historical ages are past, as the work of today is present, so some flitting perspectives and demi-experiences of the life that is in nature are in time veritably future, or rather outside to time, perennial, young, divine, in the wind and rain which never die. The respectable folks, where dwell they? They whisper in the oaks and they sigh in the hay. Summer and winter, night and day, out on the meadow, there dwell they. They never die, nor snivel, nor cry, nor ask our pity with a wet eye. A sound estate they ever mend, to every asker readily lend, to the ocean wealth, to the meadow health, to time his length, to the rock's strength, to the star's light, to the weary night, to the busy day, to the idle play, and so their good cheer never ends for all other debtors and all their friends. Concord River is remarkable for the gentleness of its current, which is scarcely perceptible, and some have referred to its influence the proverbial moderation of the inhabitants of Concord as exhibited in the Revolution and on later occasions. It has been proposed that the town should adopt for its coat of arms a field verdant, with the Concord circling 9 times round. I have read that a descent of an eighth of an inch in a mile is sufficient to produce a flow. Our river has, probably, very near the smallest allowance. The story is current, at any rate, though I believe that strict history will not bear it out, that the only bridge ever carried away on the main branch, within the limits of the town, was driven upstream by the wind. But wherever it makes a sudden bend, it is shallower and swifter, and asserts its title to be called a river. Compared with the other tributaries of the Merrimack, it appears to have been properly named Muscataquid, or Meadow River, by the Indians. For the most part, it creeps through broad meadows, adorned with scattered oaks, where the cranberry is found in abundance, covering the ground like a moss bed. A row of sunken dwarf willows borders the stream on one or both sides, while at a greater distance the meadow is skirted with maples, alders, and other fluviatile trees, overrun with the grapevine, which bears fruit in its season, purple, red, white, and other grapes. Still farther from the stream, on the edge of the firm land, are seen the gray and white dwellings of the inhabitants. According to the valuation of 1831, there were in Concord 2,111 acres, or about 1/7 of the whole territory and meadow, this standing next in the list after pasturage and unimproved lands, and, judging from the returns of previous years, the meadow is not reclaimed so fast as the woods are cleared. Let us here read what old Johnson says of these meadows in his Wonder-Working Providence, which gives the account of New England from 1628 to 1652, and see how matters look to him. He says of the 12th Church of Christ gathered at Concord, "This town is seated upon a fair fresh river, whose rivulets are filled with fresh marsh, and her streams with fish, it being a branch of that large river of Merrimack. Alewives and shad in their season come up to this town, but salmon and dace cannot come up, by reason of the rocky falls, which causeth their meadows to lie much covered with water, the which these people, together with their neighbor town, have several times essayed to cut through but cannot, yet it may be turned another way with an 100-pound charge, as it appeared. As to their farming," he says, "having laid out their estate upon cattle at 5 to 20 pound a cow, when they came to winter them with inland hay, and feed upon such wild fother as was never cut before, they could not hold out the winter, but, ordinarily the first or second year, after their coming up to a new plantation, many of their cattle died." And this from the same author, of the planting of the 19th church in the Massachusetts government called Sudbury, this year, does he mean 1654, the town and church of Christ at Sudbury began to have the first foundation stones laid, taking up her station in the inland country as her elder sister Concord had formerly done, lying further up the same river, being furnished with great plenty of fresh marsh, but it lying very low is much indamaged with land floods, insomuch that when the summer proves wet, they lose part of their hay. Yet are they so sufficiently provided that they take in cattle of other towns to winter. The sluggish artery of the Concord Meadows steals thus unobserved through the town, without a murmur or a pulse beat, its general course from southwest to northeast, and its length about 50 miles, a huge volume of matter, ceaselessly rolling through the plains and valleys of the substantial earth with the moccasin tread of an Indian warrior, making haste from the high places of the earth to its ancient reservoir. The murmurs of many a famous river on the other side of the globe reach even to us here, as to more distant dwellers on its banks, many a poet's stream floating the helms and shields of heroes on its bosom. The Xanthus or Scamander is not a mere dry channel and bed of a mountain torrent, but fed by the ever-flowing springs of fame. And thou, Simwa, that as an arrow clear, through Troy rennest, a downward to the sea. And I trust that I may be allowed to associate our muddy, but much abused Concord River, with the most famous in history. Sure there are poets which did never dream upon Parnassus, nor did taste the stream of Helicon. We therefore may suppose those made not poets, but the poets those. The Mississippi, the Ganges, and the Nile, those journeying atoms from the Rocky Mountains, the Himala and Mountains of the Moon, have a kind of personal importance in the annals of the world. The heavens are not yet drained over their sources, but the Mountains of the Moon still send their annual tribute to the Pasha without fail, as they did to the pharaohs, though he must collect the rest of his revenue at the point of the sword. Rivers must have been the guides which conducted the footsteps of the first travelers. They are the constant lure, when they flow by our doors, to distant enterprise and adventure, and by a natural impulse, the dwellers on their banks will at length accompany their currents to the lowlands of the globe, or explore at their invitation the interior of continents. They are the natural highways of all nations, not only leveling the ground and removing obstacles from the path of the traveler, quenching his thirst and bearing him on their bosoms, but conducting him through the most interesting scenery, the most populous portions of the globe, and where the animal and vegetable kingdoms attain their greatest perfection. I had often stood on the banks of the Concord, watching the lapse of the current, an emblem of all progress, following the same law with the system, with time, and all that is made. The weeds at the bottom gently bending down the stream, shaken by the watery wind, still planted where their seeds had sunk, but ere long to die and go down likewise. The shining pebbles, not yet anxious to better their condition, the chips and weeds and occasional logs and stems of trees that floated past, fulfilling their fate, were objects of singular interest to me, and at last I resolved to launch myself on its bosom and float whither it would bear me. Saturday. Come, come, my lovely fair, and let us try those rural delicacies. Christ's invitation to the soul. Carrot quarrels carrot. At length on Saturday, the last day of August, 1839, we two brothers and natives of Concord weighed anchor in this river port, for Concord, too, lies under the sun, a port of entry and departure for the bodies as well as the souls of men, one shore at least exempted from all duties but such as an honest man will gladly discharge. A warm, drizzling rain had obscured the morning, and threatened to delay our voyage, but at length the leaves and grass were dried, and it came out a mild afternoon, as serene and fresh as if nature were maturing some greater scheme of her own. After this long dripping and oozing from every pore, she began to respire again, more healthily than ever. So with a vigorous shove, we launched our boat from the bank, while the flags and bulrushes courtesied a godspeed, and dropped silently down the stream. Our boat, which had cost us a week's labor in the spring, was in form like a fisherman's dory, 15 feet long by 3.5 in breadth at the widest part, painted green below, with a border of blue, with reference to the two elements in which it was to spend its existence. It had been loaded the evening before at our door, half a mile from the river, with potatoes and melons from a patch which we had cultivated, and a few utensils, and was provided with wheels in order to be rolled around falls, as well as with two sets of oars, and several slender poles for shoving in shallow places, and also two masts, one of which served for a tent pole at night, for a buffalo skin was to be our bed, and a tent of cotton cloth our roof. It was strongly built, but heavy, and hardly of better model than usual. If rightly made, a boat would be a sort of amphibious animal, a creature of two elements, related by one half its structure to some swift and shapely fish, and by the other to some strong-winged and graceful bird. The fish shows where there should be the greatest breadth of beam and depth in the hold. Its fins direct where to set the oars, and the tail gives some hint for the form and position of the rudder. The bird shows how to rig and trim the sails, and what form to give to the prow, that it may balance the boat and divide the air and water best. These hints we had but partially obeyed. But the eyes, though they are no sailors, will never be satisfied with any model, however fashionable, which does not answer all the requisitions of art. However, as art is all of a ship but the wood, and yet the wood alone will rudely serve the purpose of a ship, so our boat being of wood, gladly availed itself of the old law that the heavier shall float the lighter, and though a dull waterfowl proved a sufficient buoy for our purpose. Were it the will of heaven, an osier bow were vessel safe enough the seas to plough. Some village friends stood upon a promontory lower down the stream to wave us a last farewell, but we, having already performed these shore rites with excusable reserve, as befits those who are embarked on unusual enterprises, who behold but speak not, silently glided past the firm lands of Concord, both peopled cape and lonely summer meadow, with steady sweeps. And yet we did unbend so far as to let our guns speak for us, when at length we had swept out of sight, and thus left the woods to ring again with their echoes, and it may be many russet-clad children lurking in those broad meadows, with the bittern and the woodcock and the rail, though wholly concealed by brakes and hardhack and meadow sweet, heard our salute that afternoon. We were soon floating past the first regular battleground of the Revolution, resting on our oars between the still visible abutments of that North Bridge, over which in April 1775 rolled the first faint tide of that war, which ceased not till, as we read on the stone on our right, it gave peace to these United States. As a Concord poet has sung, by the rude bridge that arched the flood, their flag to April's breeze unfurled. Here once the embattled farmers stood and fired the shot heard round the world. The foe long since in silence slept, alike the conqueror silent sleeps, and time the ruined bridge has swept down the dark stream which seaward creeps. Our reflections had already acquired a historical remoteness from the scenes we had left, and we ourselves essayed to sing. Ah, 'tis in vain the peaceful din that wakes the ignoble town, not thus did braver spirits win a patriot's renown. There is one field beside this stream wherein no foot does fall, but yet it beareth in my dream a richer crop than all. Let me believe a dream so dear, some heart beat high that day above the petty province here and Britain far away. Some hero of the ancient mould, some arm of knightly worth, of strength unbought and faith unsold, honored this spot of earth. Who sought the prize his heart described, and did not ask release, whose free-born valor was not bribed by prospect of a peace. The men who stood on yonder height that day are long since gone, not the same hand directs the fight and monumental stone. Ye were the Grecian cities then, the Romes of modern birth, where the New England husbandmen have shown a Roman worth. In vain I search a foreign land to find our Bunker Hill and Lexington and Concord stand by no Laconian rill. With such thoughts we swept gently by this now peaceful pasture ground on waves of Concord, in which was long since drowned the din of war. But since we sailed, some things have failed, and many a dream gone down the stream. Here then an aged shepherd dwelt, who to his flock his substance dealt, and ruled them with a vigorous crook, by precept of the sacred book, but he the peerless bridge passed o'er and solitary left the shore. Anon a youthful pastor came, whose crook was not unknown to fame. His lambs he viewed with gentle glance, spread o'er the country's wide expanse, and fed with mosses from the manse. Here was our hawthorn in the dale, and here the shepherd told his tale. That slight shaft had now sunk behind the hills, and we had floated round the neighboring bend, and under the new north bridge between Poncowtasset and the Poplar Hill, into the great meadows, which like a broad moccasin print, have leveled a fertile and juicy place in nature. On Poncowtasset, since we took our way down this still stream to far Billericay, a poet wise has settled, whose fine ray doth often shine on Concord's twilight day. Like those first stars, whose silver beams on high, shining more brightly as the day goes by, most travelers cannot at first descry, but eyes that want to range the evening sky. And no celestial lights do plainly see and gladly hail them, numbering two or three, for lore that's deep must deeply studied be, as from deep wells men read star poetry. These stars are never paled, though out of sight, but like the sun they shine forever bright. Aye, they are suns, though earth must in its flight put out its eyes that it may see their light. Who would neglect the least celestial sound, or faintest light that falls on earthly ground, if he could know it one day would be found, that star in Cygnus whither we are bound, and pale our sun with heavenly radiance round. Gradually, the village murmur subsided, and we seemed to be embarked on the placid current of our dreams, floating from past to future as silently as one awakes to fresh morning or evening thoughts. We glided noiselessly down the stream, occasionally driving a pickerel or a bream from the covert of the pads, and the smaller bittern now and then sailed away on sluggish wings from some recess in the shore, or the larger lifted itself out of the long grass at our approach and carried its precious legs away to deposit them in a place of safety. The tortoises also rapidly dropped into the water, as our boat ruffled the surface amid the willows, breaking the reflections of the trees. The banks had passed the height of their beauty, and some of the brighter flowers showed by their faded tints that the season was verging towards the afternoon of the year. But this somber tinge enhanced their sincerity, and in the still unabated heats they seemed like the mossy brink of some cool well. The narrow-leaved willow, Salix persiana, lay along the surface of the water in masses of light green foliage, interspersed with the large balls of the buttonbush. The small rose-colored polygonum raised its head proudly above the water on either hand, and flowering at this season and in these localities, in front of dense fields of the white species which skirted the sides of the stream, its little streak of red looked very rare and precious. The pure white blossoms of the arrowhead stood in the shallower parts, and a few cardinals on the margin still proudly surveyed themselves reflected in the water, though the latter, as well as the pickerel weed, was now nearly out of blossom. The snakehead, Chelone glabra, grew close to the shore, while a kind of coreopsis turning its brazen face to the sun full and rank, and a tall dull red flower, Eupatorium purpureum, or trumpet weed, formed the rear rank of the fluvial array. The bright blue flowers of the soapwort gentian were sprinkled here and there in the adjacent meadows, like flowers which Proserpine had dropped, and still farther in the fields or higher on the bank were seen the purple gerardia, the Virginian rexia, and drooping niatia or latus tresses, while from the more distant waysides which we occasionally passed, and banks where the sun had lodged, was reflected still a dull yellow beam from the ranks of tansy now past its prime. In short, nature seemed to have adorned herself for our departure with a profusion of fringes and curls, mingled with the bright tints of flowers, reflected in the water. But we missed the white water lily, which is the queen of river flowers, its rain being over for this season. He makes his voyage too late, perhaps, by a true water clock who delays so long. Many of this species inhabit our Concord water. I have passed down the river before sunrise on a summer morning between fields of lilies still shut in sleep, and when at length the flakes of sunlight from over the bank fell on the surface of the water, whole fields of white blossoms seemed to flash open before me as I floated along, like the unfolding of a banner, so sensible is this flower to the influence of the sun's rays. As we were floating through the last of these familiar meadows, we observed the large and conspicuous flowers of the hibiscus, covering the dwarf willows and mingled with the leaves of the grape, and wished that we could inform one of our friends behind of the locality of this somewhat rare and inaccessible flower before it was too late to pluck it. But we were just gliding out of sight of the village spire, before it occurred to us that the farmer in the adjacent meadow would go to church on the morrow, and would carry this news for us. And so by the Monday, while we should be floating on the Merrimack, our friend would be reaching to pluck this blossom on the bank of the Concord. After a pause at Ball's Hill, the St. Anne's of Concord voyagers, not to say any prayer for the success of our voyage, but to gather the few berries which were still left on the hills, hanging by very slender threads, we weighed anchor again and were soon out of sight of our native village. The land seemed to grow fairer as we withdrew from it. Far away to the southwest lay the quiet village, left alone under its elms and buttonwoods in mid-afternoon, and the hills, notwithstanding their blue ethereal faces, seemed to cast a saddened eye on their old playfellows. But turning short to the north, we bade adieu to their familiar outlines and addressed ourselves to new scenes and adventures. Naught was familiar, but the heavens, from under whose roof the voyager never passes, but with their countenance and the acquaintance we had with river and wood, we trusted to fare well under any circumstances. From this point, the river runs perfectly straight for a mile or more to Carlisle Bridge, which consists of 20 wooden piers, and when we looked back over it, its surface was reduced to a line's breadth, and appeared like a cobweb gleaming in the sun. Here and there might be seen a pole sticking up, to mark the place where some fisherman had enjoyed unusual luck, and in return had consecrated his rod to the deities who preside over these shallows. It was full twice as broad as before, deep and tranquil, with a muddy bottom, and bordered with willows, beyond which spread broad lagoons covered with pads, bulrushes, and flags. Late in the afternoon we passed a man on the shore fishing with a long birch pole, its silvery bark left on, and a dog at his side, rowing so near as to agitate his cork with our oars, and drive away luck for a season. And when we had rowed a mile as straight as an arrow with our faces turned towards him, and the bubbles in our wake still visible on the tranquil surface, there stood the fisher still with his dog, like statues under the other side of the heavens, the only objects to relieve the eye in the extended meadow. And there would he stand abiding his luck, till he took his way home through the fields at evening with his fish. Thus, by one bait or another, nature allures inhabitants into all her recesses. This man was the last of our townsmen whom we saw, and we silently through him bade adieu to our friends. The characteristics and pursuits of various ages and races of men are always existing in epitome in every neighborhood. The pleasures of my earliest youth have become the inheritance of other men. This man is still a fisher, and belongs to an era in which I myself have lived. Perchance he is not confounded by many knowledges, and has not sought out many inventions, but how to take many fishes before the sunset.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.